A lot of folks who grew up in the 1980s are fans of famous movie franchises, like Back to the Future or Indiana Jones. I love those films too, but I've also been drawn to many other lesser-known movies. When I was 11 years old, I became a fan of the 1985 Canadian film The Peanut Butter Solution, and that fandom would eventually form relationships, give me the strength to follow a dream, and even bring a lost, extended version of the movie to a wider audience. The film's strange offbeat humor and seemingly fever dreamlike atmosphere endeared me to the movie. But for a generation of children who were just a few years younger than me, this film left a nightmarish scar on many of their minds. Join me as I set out to explore my own fandom, the famous and sometimes infamous legacy, and the strange true story of The Peanut Butter Solution. Every film that is made has a story about its creation, and a story about its place in the public consciousness, whether famous, forgotten, or infamous. In September of 2019, I took a trip from San Francisco to Montreal to collect interviews and footage for this documentary about 1985's The Peanut Butter Solution. We're going to explore the origins, creation, and legacy of that movie. But first, we're going to do a recap of the film. Those of you who have not seen this movie and don't want spoilers, jump to this time in the video. Otherwise, stay with the countdown and hold on tight. This is Michael. He has a sister named Susie, a father named Billy who is an artist, and a mother named Betty who is away in Australia selling her late father's house. He also has a best friend named Connie. Connie tells Michael about a fire at a mansion where some homeless folks were camping and died, folks that Michael gave some money to just a few days before. Michael wants to look inside the mansion. Instead, they go to art class where a teacher named the Senor crumples up Michael's drawing for using his imagination and drawing flames. Michael finally climbs into the mansion after school. Something frightens him unconscious. Connie takes him home, and the next day all his hair is gone. The hair won't grow back, and Michael wears a wig, which gets pulled off his head during a soccer match. The Senor is fired from the school for giving the kids nightmares, and for his shady past as an artist. One night, the ghosts of the homeless people give Michael a recipe, which contains gross ingredients, to grow his hair back. It works, but he didn't heed the warnings not to use too much peanut butter, and now his hair is growing too long too quickly. Michael walks to school one day and is kidnapped, along with many other neighborhood children. Susie and Connie go to an art store to buy Billy a new paintbrush to cheer him up, but find a brush made out of Michael's hair, which was made by the Senor. They make a plan to stop the Senor's schemes using a trail of sugar, but it goes awry, and Connie ends up in a hair paintbrush sweatshop with magic paintings people can walk into. Connie manages to trick the Senor into painting the mansion. He looks inside to see the fright, freeing Michael from the curse and passing it on to him. Susie finds the trail of sugar and the sweatshop. Michael finds out that the homeless people were the fright. Michael and Connie nearly escape when Billy, Susie, and crew come to the rescue. Michael's family returns home, and so does Betty. Of those who watched this movie as a child, nearly every person I speak to says that they thought the film was just a bad dream they had. If you had a similar reaction, you're not alone. To find out why this film evokes such strange and specific memories, we're going to start by talking about the film's creator, who is just one member of a family with a long history centered around art and creativity. Michael Ribot was born in 1938 in Melbourne, Australia. Ribot attended Scotch College and Sydney University before receiving his MA in filmmaking at Stanford University. While at Stanford, Michael created his first documentary, The True Source of Knowledge. In 1966, Michael joined up with the National Film Board of Canada, and in the coming years, many acclaimed documentaries followed, cementing his own personal style of speaking and appearing in his documentaries. With his wife, Katerina, Michael Ribot had two children, Ellen and Nicholas. One day, when Ribot's reading bedtime stories to his son Nicholas, Ribot came up with a new story.
He had a son of 10 years old at the time, and every evening before going to sleep, his son would say, "Dad, tell me a story." And so Michael would go in the library, take books and read the story. And he had read all of them. And his son keeps asking, "Dad, if you cannot read me a story, invent me a story." So he invented the story of Michael's fright, which became Peanut Butter Solution. And strangely, Michael told me that among many stories that he has invented, every 2-3 days his son will ask him, "Please, Dad, tell me that story once more." So that's why he then put it on paper, 15 pages, and that's the 15 pages he presented to me, and that's how we started working together.
The main antagonist of the film, the Signor, was a character based on Rubbo's real-life grandfather. Antonio Totillo Rubbo was born in 1870 in Napoli, Italy. Antonio grew up in Italy's famous city of art, Frata Maggiore. And in 1897, Totillo Rubbo emigrated to Sydney, Australia, where he eventually became a well-known artist and art teacher at many of Sydney's best schools, helping to spur the modernist art movement in Australia. Like his fictional counterpart, he was a teacher who was strict with his students, and part of his curriculum was to teach many a student drawing in charcoal. But unlike his fictional counterpart, instead of crumpling up art he found to be of poor quality, the Signor would carry a feather duster and would erase a student's drawing, forcing them to start from scratch. But Michael Rubbo and his grandfather are just one part of this story. Roque de Mer was born in 1933. In the early 80s, he started the production company Les Productions La Fête. One day, Demir was shocked by what he read in the news.
That was a very important moment I still remember. And I was on Saturday morning going through a newspaper, thinking to other things, and suddenly I saw a title, "Children Committing Suicide," and with statistic. And I said, "How is that possible?" I was 50 years old then. And I said, "I know life is difficult, but it's worthwhile. And what could I do?"
Demel's response was to create a series of family films, which he soon dubbed Contes pour tous, Tales for All.
A series of films where the main character would be kids, boys and girls. The story will take place today, not science fiction, nor a history film, and with lots of humor.
First, Roque de Mer had to find funding. De Mer's search brought him to the National Film Board headquarters in Saint-Laurent, Quebec.
At the film board, they said, "To follow up with you, it will be Jacques Bobet." So I met with Jacques, and Jacques told me, "There is a filmmaker here at the film board that has submitted to me a story which might interest you in your Tales for All's," and that's how I met Michael.
Rubbo then left the National Film Board to begin work on his screenplay. Meanwhile, the first film in the series, La Guerre des Ducs, released in October 1984, turned out to be a hit.
And we were going around the country doing interview in radio station on TV, and I was in a small city named Three Rivers, and I was waiting for my turn to be interviewed, and just before me, it was an interview with Céline Dion.
A young Céline Dion was still in the process of learning English at the time.
My dream is to be an international star.
During the interview, she was invited to sing twice, and I love her voice. And when she came out of the studio, I said, "Would you like to consider the possibility of interpreting songs for my next project?" Because she had heard of The Dogs of the War, and she said yes, and then I contacted her manager, and that's how she was part of the project.
Unlike the French language La Guerre des Ducs, which was dubbed into English as The Dog Who Stopped the War, the second film in the Tales for All series was to be shot in English and dubbed into French. The screenwriting process was underway.
Michael is so imaginative, has so many ideas, that I will sit with him and discuss and make a suggestion. This, maybe it's a little bit longer. What do you think if we will take that approach instead of this one? And Michael will go back home, and at once, for 3 days, without sleeping, he rewrote a script and came back, and we discuss it. And sometimes we had decided to, let's say, change 5 scenes. But after he had changed those 5 scenes, he decided to change 5 other ones. So he will come back in the cinema with a new script. And it was a very long process. It was 12, 13 versions to have the ready for the shoot.
To find the children who acted in the film, Daniel Pettinaud, previously a co-writer on Les Guerres du Tuc, was tasked with the casting of the English language child stars in the film.
Yeah, I was 10 years old, and I was going to Roslyn Elementary School in Montreal. I'd actually done some acting work before, because both of my parents are in theater. I'd done a few films, but just really small things.
I was actually going to a French grade school at the time, but my mother was working at the National Film Board, where Michael Rubeau was doing some work. And she heard that they were going around looking for a kid, and she suggested that I could also audition, seeing as they were looking for anybody.
And just one day, a group of casting agents came in and explained that they were shooting a movie.
They were looking for a kid who didn't have any experience, and they were actually going around in all the English-speaking grade schools.
Probably all the English, primary English schools in Montreal.
And just picking out some individuals they thought could look good for the part.
Michael Rubeau, he would go there and tell the kids class by class the story. And at the same time, he will look at the boys and girls, how they react.
And they asked how many people had seen Les Guerres du Tuc, and their whole class had just seen it, like literally the day before. So all of our hands shut up. Like, okay, well, this is like the next movie in the series, and we're looking for some actors.
And then he would decide, you and you.
And you come outside. That's all we did. We literally just, okay, so 3 of us went out, gave our names, and we all went and auditioned.
So I got a first audition, and then I got a second audition, and then a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, and a sixth, and a seventh, and an eighth, and a ninth. 9 auditions, actually.
And so I just auditioned and got the part. And yeah, they found the rest of us like that, too.
And finally, they decided I was the one, the golden child, the peanut butter kid.
Montreal wasn't the only place they went on their search. The casting call traveled from Montreal to Toronto for the casting of Conrad Connie Wong, played by Laotian-born Silik Seysanassi.
And I did 3 films after this one with Michael Rubeau, and it was the same process all the time. Because the secret in casting film with children, since they are not professional, it's to find somebody who is, if possible, exactly the character that is in the script. Then he won't have to play as himself.
I had an older brother and an older sister, and so, you know, I always had to kind of fight for my time in the spotlight, and, you know, was always trying to get their sort of attention and acceptance and all that. So I think I was already kind of outgoing and expressive. And so then I just, you know, I think I was probably already a bit of an actor by nature as a kid. So they were looking for a natural read. And, you know, I had some, I guess, some abilities that they liked. And so it all worked out.
And that's very strange and so fascinating for me, after so many films, to find out that in many cases, those kids who had never seen a camera, never acted in a movie, be as good as a very well-known actor, internationally known. And it does not mean that the kid will become an actor later on. It's just at that point in their life, they are the character that are in the script. And you have to find it. And if you find it, it's magic.
one of the women who was the casting agent has now turned into a filmmaker in her own right, and she's now a friend of mine. You know, I've auditioned for her, and we've, you know, talked about working together, and she's amazing, Brenda Kiesel.
The adult roles in the film were played by seasoned actors who brought their own style to the production. Michael Hogan, the son of a prospector, was born in 1949 in Kirkland Lake, Ontario. Hogan later appeared in series such as Battlestar Galactica as Colonel Saul Tai, The L Word, Fargo, 12 Monkeys, and The Man in the High Castle. Unfortunately, in February of 2020, Hogan suffered an accident, leaving him paralyzed on his left side. If you would like to donate to Michael Hogan's recovery, there's a link to his family's GoFundMe for medical expenses in the page description. Born in 1926, Michel Maillot later had a role as Mr. Carruthers in 1990's Vincent and Me, another Michael Rubeau-directed tale for all that centers around art. Born in 1918, Helen Hughes later had roles in films like Billy Madison, Tommy Boy, and the miniseries Storm of the Century. Griffith Brewer, born in 1922, had been acting since the 1950s. Like Matthew McKay, Brewer was later in several episodes of the Nickelodeon series Are You Afraid of the Dark? Acting was just one of Brewer's many passions. He was a consummate prop master for various Montreal stage productions, and also had many hobbies such as carpentry, creating musical instruments, making puppets, and restoring antiques. Having had a heart condition that took away his eyesight in later years, Brewer contributed his time to organizations for the blind as well.
Griff was like a long time family friend. He worked with my parents at their respective theaters, and he actually was the carpenter at my father's theater, like my whole childhood. And I would go down and sit with him and watch him build things. And a lot of the furniture in our house was like old props that he had made. He was a master, kind of master woodworker, but also, I mean, just one of the most gentle, kind people and fun. And he was always an old man in my life. He was always just an old man. But he was just, you know, I don't have grandparents because they all died when I was really young. So he was always kind of one of those figures for me.
Harry Hill, born in 1940 in Aberdeen, Scotland, had roles in movies such as The Moderns, Some Girls, Enemies, A Love Story, and the series Wunsch Punch. Hill lived his life in film and on the Montreal stage, was a theater teacher beloved by many, and was made a laureate of the Quebec Theater.
I remember when we were filming, I was such a brat. I guess I didn't realize, but I kept going up to him and poking his belly and saying, "Oh, you're wearing a fake belly." And he's like, "No, I'm not." I'm like, "No, it's fake." He's like, it's not fake. It's fake. And I don't know why, I was absolutely convinced it was a fake belly and that he was messing with me. And he kept telling me that, like, he would tell me that backstage, like, as we're about to walk on a plane, he's like, "It's a real belly." And then I had to go out on stage and be like a sad German girl and like, in like a post-Nazi, you know, like, play. He's like, it's a real belly. He was a lovely man.
Edgar Froutier, born in 1930, was in the series Terre Humaine and later went on to star in L'Anse et Comte. Pat Thompson, born in 1927, was the editor of the Canadian Film Digest. A phone call from Roch de Mer and a videotaped audition brought the sole acting credit of Miss Prume to her name. Terence Lebrosse, born in 1933, voiced Sancho in the English dub of the animated series The Mysterious Cities of Gold. Lebrosse was also in Are You Afraid of the Dark? Once casting was finalized, shooting commenced on Wednesday, April 10th, 1985.
They asked me what I wanted to have in my room, and they're like, "Tell us all the things that you would want, we'll decorate your room." And then...
But your room wasn't in the movie.
It was not in the movie. They made a whole room for me, and it was like all the posters I wanted. It was my dream kid room, and it never got into the movie.
Every day, I had to go onto set like an hour early so that they could shave my head, and my scalp was very sensitive, and it actually hurt quite a lot to get my head shaved every day with those razors.
I just suddenly got a visceral memory of going up into the attic, and I used to go and look at all the paintings whenever we were on break. I would go up and look at the paintings, and they had all these like dishes of unused food, like of moldy food, and they were for real. And I remember just like, it smelled I just got a very strong memory of being up in that attic looking at these bird paintings and smelling like moldy bread.
In the film, you know, for like 95% of the film, what is supposed to be my real hair, as the character Michael Baskin, I was actually wearing a wig. That's not my natural hair color. It was a little bit redder. And the reason they gave me a wig and didn't use my natural hair is because, of course, the film is shot out of continuity, meaning they would shoot scenes based on location, not based on chronology in the story. So because in parts of the film I'm bald, at other parts I have very long hair, at other parts it's my quote-unquote real hair, they decided it'd be much simpler, and it was much simpler if they just had a wig for my supposedly real hair that then they could just whip off if they were then going to shoot a scene where I was bald, or if then they needed to change the wig for a long hair. So most of the time it's a wig that I'm wearing in any case.
One memory I have is of them having to take photos of my hands because they needed to find a match for the kid who's going to play the piano. And they took pictures of my hands, and then they said, we're going to find a little girl who has the same hands. And then I came in and it was a little boy dressed up in my outfit. And he was so cute. And he just did this amazing piano. We were shocked. And then I had to sit down and mimic it. And I remember there's a whole section where you have, it's like, I put my hand up, like I'm not, and it's like, I'm just doing one hand and then down and then the other hand or something. And I remember him teaching that to me. And he was just like really little kid, but he was a virtuoso.
This scene where the bully kind of pulls off the wig and then everyone's running after me and I'm running away in shame and humiliation and crying. It was funny because during the filming of the movie, at that time I had no hair, right? Because I was shooting the film. So I was bald. I basically shaved my head every day. You know, when I wasn't on set shooting the movie, I was just a kid living my life. So I'd get on the bus and people, they didn't know what the heck was going on. So, but I, being a bit of a ham and this and that, I kind of enjoyed that, as opposed to the character in the film who was kind of like very scared. I was kind of loving it. And there was one experience where I actually went to my grade school while I was shooting the film. And I think I had a hood on or something like that. And then I went into the schoolyard and everybody was there. And then I kind of like pulled off my hood to kind of see what the reaction was. And then, like in the movie, a swarm of kids kind of all came around and they were all kind of like laughing and pointing, and they actually started chasing after me. But in this particular case, you know, I just thought it was kind of fun and hilarious. I wasn't traumatized by it at all. I kind of, you know, loved the reaction. But so that was just kind of an interesting contrast between, you know, the character's experience and my own personal experience, you know, knowing why I was doing it and the reason and everything, you know. So that was kind of fun.
I remember going on a lunch break one time with Matthew and everybody. And we were sitting there, we'd all ordered our food, and this is Matt, okay? He's like, can I have a sip of your orange drink? I'm like, okay, and he has a sip. And he's like, can I have another one? I'm like, you just had one. And then I went up and went to the bathroom, and I came back, and he goes to reach for it, I grab it, and I take a sip immediately, and he put salt in it, and he totally just psychologically knew that if he reached for it, I would grab it and drink it right away. And I just had this mouthful of salt, and I just thought that was, I remember even noticing at that age that was like a psychologically genius move.
For the particular segment in the film where I've just the night before put on the peanut butter solution on my head, the magic potion to make my hair grow, then the following morning we see my hair kind of growing back in a sequence of shots. And the way they did that actually was they did, in that case, use my real hair, and they just shot the sequence of shots in reverse. So they shot the end of the scene first with my hair kind of long, and then they cut my hair a little bit, and then they went back a little bit in the chronology to just before that moment, and then shot another, say, 10 seconds, and then cut my hair, and then went back. progressively to where I was bald, and then I had a shaved head. So then when you see it, it looks like, okay, for this 10 seconds, my hair is, I have no hair. Then next 10 seconds, I have a little bit of hair and then a little bit more. So it just creates the illusion of my hair growing back, but they just shot it backwards. There are all these assistant directors, you know, second AD, third AD, and production assistants and everything, you know, who are there to kind of rein us in. But I guess there were, what, 50 kids all together out of school with no parents around. So, and you know that on a movie set, like 90% of the time you're waiting to film, not actually filming. So that was a lot of free time where we were together. And of course, tremendous exuberance and energy in this kind of cool location. And I think we were given a fair amount of freedom to sort of have some fun within, you know, different areas of the space. So, you know, I remember we had a lot of fun. We were running around playing and, you know, maybe a little wild. No one got hurt, I don't think. I hope not. I don't think so. But yeah, we had a fun time.
Almost as important as the people were the locations chosen for filming. Nearly every scene is shot on location, adding to the film's unique feel. The Baskin home is a prime example. The family who lived at the house at the time of filming ran a haunted house every Halloween up until 2015, when the home was sold. The burnt-out mansion on Chemin de la Côte-Sainte-Catherine was an actual building abandoned a few years previous to filming. Home of the Montreal Hunt Club from 1898, when the area was rural, up until the 1940s when development had started to move into the area, the building then changed hands many times. Adjacent Saint-Justine Hospital bought the property. For years, that property was ostensibly left abandoned. Sometime after filming, the hospital built a parking lot around the mansion. Around the year 2000, the building was finally torn down, and in 2014, Saint-Justine Hospital built a new expansion on the site. Nothing remains of the once grand mansion that graced the property. On Saint-Denis Street, where there was once an art supply store, there is now a bed and breakfast.
When we were filming that scene in front of the art supply store, I remember that they gave me this selection of magazines to choose from, and the one that I really wanted had Duran Duran on it because I was an obsessive fan, and I remember I was so proud about placing it so that the back of the magazine had Duran Duran on it, and it was like showing to the camera. And then I even like came up with this idea of having it backwards at one point, then switching it over just so that people could really see the Duran Duran, because I was obsessed.
Montreal has changed considerably in the last 3 decades, but that doesn't mean we can't still go for a bike ride. As art plays a major role in the film, Toronto artist Brian Burnett had many of his paintings shown in this movie. Burnett also painted the large canvas painting that Billy is seen creating in the film. The same painting, entitled Tennis Match, hung on the wall of Roch de Meo's office for more than 20 years. I was lucky enough to see this painting in person during many of my interviews for this documentary. In addition to Brian Burnett's art, the opening credits of the film are framed by a series of paintings that depict the characters and events of the movie. These paintings, as well as the magic paintings seen later in the film, were created at Les Productions Pascal Blais. The movie's magic paintings were brought to life using a combination of matte paintings, optical effects, and hand-drawn animation. I spoke about these special effects with the film's magic paintings and animation producer, Bernard Lajoie.
Doing that kind of what we call optical effects at that time, it was to the way it was done, it was not on computers, it was technology wasn't there at that point. We had what we call optical printers. Optical printers is basically that you're reshooting the original neg that you shot on the scene in multiple layers and multiple exposure, but all that on a 35 millimeter frame, so you had to create a mask to do the insertion with the optical printer one by one with multiple exposure, and at that time that was something. We actually had a company in Montreal called Film Doctor who had an optical printer, and we did also some tests with them to see how far we could go with blue screens. We did a few storyboards for that to determine really precisely what would be the shots that we would shoot that all in camera locks. And we were shooting with kids, which was not easy. So we spent, it took us a lot of different tests, you know, to fix, you know, the air and all that, and but it worked. And the other part was to do the animation when we do the when he's creating the painting, to do the reveal mats when he's punching on the blue screen behind, and so we had quite a lot of rotoscoping to do. Rotoscoping meaning that you had to take the original shoot, put it in a projector frame by frame, and create by hand some mats to really make a nice cut around everything. And quite a few scenes were saved that way.
Sound plays just as important a role as the visual effects in any film. I spoke with Claude Langlois about the sound of the movie.
It's a kind of a melting with music and, let's say, special effects that I done with a friend of mine. So we have this atmospheric ideas about the senior and what's happening with this young guy. So it was very interesting to work on something that it was not, it's the only film of the Conte pour tous that have this kind of special ambience, and it was in the same time bizarre, but a dark one. So it was very powerful in the same time. And the challenge that I have is to, yes, to manage with that, but not too much. We have to melt it with the real stuff and the music and going out, going in. We were prepared to do it in stereo, but we did a mono finally. And Rock de Messe wanted like this at that time, and he was right, because the major distribution system was mono at that time.
Another incredibly unique aspect of the Peanut Butter Solution was its music. I spoke with Luis Fiore about his involvement with the film.
At that point, I was just beginning to do film scores. I had crossed over from classical music to songwriting, and I had made a couple of records, and I'd done a couple of film scores. And Ruck de Meers, who was a friend of my wife, Carol Lohr, called me. And I was eager to do film scores, and Ruck was charming and very involved in his films, and very seemed like the sort of producer I would like to work with. It was a very intelligent approach that he had. He didn't have that appearance of a lot of producers at the time who were very slick. There was nothing slick about him. I had really no preconception of what music for children was and should be. You know, I really couldn't have cared less what other people were doing. I was doing what I thought was appropriate. Well, it was when I was working on this kind of pop cabaret music, you know, with an influenced by Kurt Weill's cabaret music, you know, and so. You know, I could do the tangos, but as North American tangos, not to be legitimate Argentinian tangos, but this kind of pop rock, whatever, this fusion kind of all the influences that I had. And so, yes, there was that kind of cabaret style. That's what I liked about working in films, that I could do a kind of theatrical music. My pop records were theatrical as well, as were my shows. But here, it was fun to do it on film as well. Ruck had this new, a contact with this new young girl who was 16, and she was doing concerts around Quebec, and everybody said she had a wonderful voice. And he sent her over to my house, and it was Celine Dion, who was, you know, she came with her father, a sweet young girl who had never sung in English before, but we had sent her the words to the song in English, and she had studied them, and so her English was impeccable. And that was a lovely meeting with a charming, charming girl.
Utilizing an editing process that was new at that time, the 35mm negatives of the Peanut Butter Solution were transferred to video and were edited using special software. But this process wasn't without its technical difficulties.
We shot it in 35mm and then transfer everything on video to do the whole post-production, to do the special effects, and to do the mix of the sound, everything. And when the film was completed, to bring it back to film. But then I had a tough week, because technically, at that point in time, they were unable to bring the film back, the movie back to film support. And we had to go to Los Angeles to find some technicians there to be able to see our film. There's a small budget, $2 million film, which at the time was quite an important budget still for films made here, but for a week, that $2 million was lost.
Filming was completed on Saturday, May 25th, 1985. Once the final edit was recovered, the marketing phase had begun. The title of the film had been changed from Michael's Fright to the Peanut Butter Solution. As a producer, Roch de Meus found an interesting company with which to cross-promote the film.
I had a approach a company in Montreal because what I wanted was money for the launching of the film, part of the to be seen on the screen. So I remember when the film was completed, I took a copy, took a plane, fly to Toronto to go to that company, and I met a young lady. She was about 29 years old. She was in, has been asked to meet me and see the film and decide if they would participate or not. And she loved the film and said yes. And there was $100,000 to start promoting the film.
Skippy's involvement helped in a big way to promote the film in both English and French. A movie poster was created featuring the illustrated art of Yvonne Adam. A novelization was released, with illustrations based on the paintings from the film's opening credits. A soundtrack album, featuring both of Celine Dion's songs, bookending a condensed storybook version of the film, narrated by Michael, was released on both record and cassette. Early editions of the record even came with a movie poster. 45s of Celine Dion's singles were sent to Canadian radio stations, some with a promotional message on Side B.
See the movie at selected Odeon theaters. Movie soundtrack available at your favorite record location on CBS Records and Cassettes.
Celine even shot her first English language music video. The time had finally come. With many months of writing, planning, location scouting, casting, shooting, and post-production complete, the film was at long last ready for Canadian moviegoers. The film premiered in Montreal on Wednesday, December 4th, 1985, in two theaters simultaneously, in English at Cinéma Bonaventure and in French at Place du Canada. The film went into a wider release across Canada on December 6th. Being the second film in this new series, The Peanut Butter Solution had big shoes to fill. At the box office, the film had not done as well as La Guerre des Tuques, but had still done well. Some reviews were positive, some reviews were negative. The soundtrack was nominated for two Genie Awards, for Achievement in Music, Best Original Score, and Michael's Song for Best Original Song. Celine even performed Michael's Song at the 7th Genie Awards in March 1986.
Our fifth nominated song is from Michael Ruvo's delightful The Peanut Butter Solution. The movie's about a young boy who experiments with a bizarre recipe for overcoming his sudden baldness. Here to sing Michael's Song is Quebec's most popular singer. At age 17, she has gold records in both Canada and France. Celine Dion.
Meanwhile, in the United States, New World Pictures had seen Miramax's success in acquiring the English dub of La Guerre des Tuques and releasing it in the U.S. New World acquired the rights to show The Peanut Butter Solution in the U.S. in early 1986. New World also created their own trailer to market the film to American audiences, presenting it as a heartwarming comedy, and oddly leaving out any mention of the Signor from the trailer. New World Pictures also commissioned a new poster painted by Robert Florzak. By late 1986 and early 1987, The Peanut Butter Solution had made its way into rotation on U.S. pay cable networks, first airing on HBO and later the Disney Channel. As I was conducting interviews in 2019, the people I interviewed had their own question for me. Why do you like The Peanut Butter Solution so much? While I gave different responses to different people, all of them were true. But up until recently, I had never stopped to think about the question, why do I like this movie so much? I must have been about 11 years old the first time I saw this movie. Like so many children of the 80s, I had a single parent, and I had plenty of time after school to watch TV. When I first saw The Peanut Butter Solution, It was unlike any other film that I had ever seen. I identified with the characters in the film, who were children my age. They seemed to exist in their own world. A world that was lonely, dangerous, and full of hidden magic. Although the main characters had parents, teachers, and other authority figures, the only ones who seemed to be able to save the children from certain peril were themselves. And I think that resonated with me as a child. As a film score fan, I loved the cues from this movie, and I even recorded some of the audio from the film onto a cassette. Louis Fury's score, with dialogue, traveled with me as a 14-year-old, staring all night at a beach in Fort Lauderdale. By my early 20s, I had come to appreciate the film as its own quirky piece of Canadian cinema. Every time I'd describe the movie to friends, they'd think the description of it was so strange as to be a tall tale on my part, or that they had seen the movie and had since forgotten about it. Eventually, as I got older and I spent more time on the internet, I found out that most people who had seen this movie as a child seemed to think it was some sort of half-forgotten dream. This became more and more of a curiosity to me, as I had never heard of a movie that has had that sort of effect on so many people. For a while, I even had Robert Florzak's poster framed on my wall. When a sweetie came over to my house, they looked at the poster and said, "Oh, I remember that movie." And we bonded over it. Now, the movie holds a certain nostalgia for me. Nostalgia, and other geeky endeavors, is why I started the channel Seamless Branching, starting with this very video. In 2020, when living in a world where simply leaving your house is its own kind of fright, looking back to other times provides me and others with a sense of comfort. For many others, though, this film had a very different effect.
When you try to explain the plot, there's a lot of people that think that you're making it up. So there came a point where I thought I had just made this movie up, like in childlike logic.
I saw this as a kid, and I couldn't remember the name of the movie, or I couldn't remember what it was. I remembered a basic outline of the plot. I told my friends, and they're like, "Bull, that movie doesn't exist. That's not a real thing
at all. Yeah, right?
For years, I actually forgot that I watched it. It was innocuous enough to forget, but strange enough that it lied dormant in my subconscious. As the years passed, I was actually convinced that this movie never existed, that it was some awful dream I had as a kid.
And I saw this traumatic movie. I only half believed it existed, and then I think I saw it again years later. And was like, "Yeah, see everybody? It's weird." I think I watched it maybe even in school.
I think a lot of people saw this movie when they were younger and sort of were freaked out and weirded out by it for good reasons. I think this movie to me has a very like Roald Dahl of the North kind of vibe.
I actually sat down and watched this movie, and I gotta say, it's one of the weirdest children's films I've ever seen. It's a lot weirder than I remember it.
Oh, I loved this movie when I was a kid, and then I revisited it as an adult and went, "What the f*** is happening?"
Now, let me just say, this movie, straight off the bat, is not for everyone. It's a very weird and peculiar movie.
There are so many people who have had posts online on IMDb and many sites saying how they felt like this movie was a dream. They felt like they dreamed this movie, and then when they find out the title, like, it was real, it wasn't a dream.
This movie sticks in people's minds. Folks can't quite seem to remember the peanut butter solution, but they can't quite seem to forget it. I asked the folks involved how they feel about the effect this film has on its audience.
This is what I do really enjoy about the film, is that a lot of strange people all around have these memories of it as if it was a nightmare that they had when they were young, or a fever dream, or whatever it may be. I saw lists of, you know, like Jason Schwartzman, people saying that it's like their favorite cult films and stuff.
And I was told, not at the time, but later on, that many kids, the under 8 especially, had nightmare. But the older kids, from what I have heard, from what I was told, were fascinated by the film and enjoy it a lot.
I think that Michael Rubo, you know, as a good storyteller, he wasn't really holding back. He wasn't sugarcoating things. He was kind of like telling the story as it is. And of course, it has a happy ending, and there's a lot of humor and a lot of love and playfulness. But when it's dark, it's dark. I mean, if a kid is getting kidnapped, he's getting kidnapped. And if, you know, he's being laughed at on the soccer field, that's really happening. So I think because it was done kind of truthfully in that way, emotionally, everybody was completely absorbed in that story and were feeling those same emotions, and it was activating their deep feelings, their deep fears as well. So I think that's why it kind of struck so deep, and why 30 years later, when I see somebody and they find out that I was in that movie, they say, "Oh my God, that movie. Oh my God, that movie. I remember that movie. And that movie really had a deep effect on me."
Well, it's weird because every once in a while I'll run across someone who's clearly just smoked a joint and watched that film. And then they see me on the street and they kind of take a little double take and either will look a bit creeped out or be like, "Oh yes. My God, l'opération Beurre de Peanut." Like, yeah, don't worry. I'm not gonna like rip a wig off my head. I'm the stuff of people's nightmares.
Yes, we traumatized a generation.
I think that's how I feel about it. I don't remember it all, but I can't forget it.
This film was never scary for me. In fact, I always found it full of interesting yet trivial details. Speaking of, here's some trivia about the peanut butter solution that you may have missed. There's a family of four siblings in the film. The Signor, the Rabbit, Dr. Epstein, and Tom. Tom mentions that he has
lots of brothers.
Dr. Epstein says,
"We were four brothers, one just died."
And also mentions that the Rabbit and Signor are twins. And when Billy asks the Rabbit about his brother, the Rabbit mentions each of his brothers, even saying that
he died, I think.
Also, the Signor says some pretty creepy things to his students in Italian. Another piece of trivia that I discovered ended up being not so trivial. Midnights for Maniacs, a San Francisco series of themed double and triple features, hosted their after-school special triple feature in March of 2011 at the Roxy Theater. For the event, Jesse Hawthorne Fix had rented a 35mm print of the peanut butter solution from La Fête, and I was transfixed as I saw the movie that I had only seen on VHS up until then. This was the first time I got to see the movie in widescreen. I was also very surprised at what else I saw, extra scenes that I had never seen before.
No leads?
No. Leads and lead nowhere. I like that boy.
From 2011 on, I tried to find these scenes on other home video releases from both the US and Canada. But despite the 96-minute runtime listed on most of these releases, I had no luck. Eventually, Midnights for Maniacs had another showing of the movie in 2017 at Alamo Drafthouse. I was bound and determined to get video of all the extra scenes with my phone, because I couldn't find them anywhere else. I ended up recording about 85% of the missing footage, and made a YouTube video to share with folks. Meanwhile, I found out that most of the Tales for All series had been transferred in HD. Since the films were only available on Videotron streaming service in Canada, I was out of luck in finding a high-quality version until Unidisc released a Blu-ray disc in Canada in April of 2017. I imported the disc, and while I was happy to have it in HD, the disc had many issues, such as an incorrect frame cadence, most of the sound effects missing on the English track, and a very dark picture. Jump forward to 2019. In preparing for this documentary, I spoke with Matthew McKay, and he let me know that he had already recorded a commentary track for Severn Films' upcoming Blu-ray. I sent the folks at Severn an email outlining the problems with the Unidisc release. I also mentioned the extra scenes I saw in the Midnights for Maniacs showings. Severn had no idea about these extra scenes. I pointed them to my YouTube video and gave them detailed info on the Midnights for Maniacs showings that I went to. They tracked down the print that had these scenes, transferred it, and included this extended cut in their December 2019 release. Here's what Roch de Meuse had to say about this print of the film.
It was after we had our first screening in the cinema when the film was released, because and it has been true for the previous film and all films after, I go about 30 times in cinema with an audience to feel the reaction of the public. And I felt after two screenings that it was a little bit long and something that was not really necessary for the film. So with Michael, we decided to take it out. Out of 75 35 millimeter prints that we had at the time of the release here in Canada, then we brought it back to 10 prints and get rid of it, and time passed. And finally, we kept one print, and that was the print number one, which has nearly not been used. And after 35 years, with the change of people in charge of footage, and nobody realized that the only print we had saved was the one, the uncut one.
Even the original camera negative had these scenes removed. In other words, the single print of the film, the very first English language release print struck back in 1985, was the only copy with these scenes. If not for the Midnights for Maniac showings, if not for my geekery with the YouTube video and the decision to work on this documentary, and if not for Matthew McKay's info about Severin, this version of the film might have been lost to time. In addition to the extended cut, there's a lot of good stuff on Severin's Blu-ray. For instance, I didn't get to interview Cilic Sanasi for this video, but Severin did a great interview with him. There's also a commentary track with Roch Demers and Matthew McKay. There's a link to Severin's site in the description. Speaking of geekery, remember how I said the soundtrack album had a storybook version of the film? This means that Louis Furey's unique and beautiful Genie-nominated score, save for a single cue on a 45, has never been released by itself. So, I'm starting a petition. If you'd like to see a full score for this movie, please go to the petition by following the link in the description. Last, but certainly not least, I wanted to know what people took away from the experience of making this film.
I think at the time, I was always a little embarrassed because she was so bossy and kind of, you know, the not fun one, and I kind of felt a bit, oh, you know, I'm playing the, you know, the, she's not cool, you know? But now understanding a little bit more about how she's portrayed in the book as well, but how some people have taken to her over the years, I'm kind of understanding her as being, yeah, more of a kind of a strong female part. Kind of understanding that, yeah, she took on the role of the parent that was missing, and she made sure her brother was safe, and she was just always worrying about everyone and trying to take care of things, but also not afraid to put herself in danger to save her brother. And so actually she's a great little character, and I'm glad that I have a chance to revisit that and recognize that.
I'm happily surprised that a film has touched several generations, you know.
I think in some sense the film, although it's quite fantastic in a way, it's emotionally pretty true, and it kind of strikes at the heart of, you know, many natural human emotions.
I mean, I think the thing that also really made it magical was that we all genuinely had a lot of good energy together. We all enjoyed each other and made each other laugh, and
yeah,
and felt very safe and respected. And Mike Rubo was quite a leader in such a magical way. Like he was very inspiring, and he really made you want to do your best. The fact that, like, first of all, it never got produced is amazing to me, because it is so bizarre and frightening, but so magical and exciting. And I mean, what a risk that they took with this. And the fact that they just let Michael go with it and really put all of his imagination into it without holding back was so brave.
I had the opportunity 2 years ago to go in a cinema on a matinee to present the film to the people there. And after the end of the film, one lady who was with her little girl about 10 years old told me, what a gentle, frightening film. I loved it.
For a few years, there have been talks about remakes of some of Lafitte's classic films, including The Peanut Butter Solution. Will it actually happen? Right now, that's anybody's guess. But if it does happen, maybe soon I'll have another reason to head back to Montreal, and I'll have another story to tell.
Do we look washed out?
No, you don't look washed out. You all
look fine. We look sexy as fuck.
Yeah, sure.
Oh my god. Are we sexy
as fuck? Are we
though?
Are we sexy?
I'm like,
I'm really a hottie. I'm the hottest hottie that ever hotted.
My god. You are like so.
Oh, do you want to like? Do you want to like actually talk to each other in this establishing shot, or?
Okay. Pretending that we're talking, or
yes.
Actually talking.
You could actually.
Rhubarb.
Or.
I don't know. I go all animatronic when I'm talking to someone. Yes.
I'm gonna die, y'all. Seriously.
Okay.
Don't look at the camera. Oh, you look at her.
Stop laughing.
I'm.
Okay, giggles out.
Thank you so much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, give the video a thumbs up. If you didn't, give it a thumbs down. And also feel free to subscribe and hit that notification bell for more seamless branching geekiness. I'll see you all next time. Bye for now.